Hachette Audio presents It's Not About Whiteness, It's About Wealth: How the Economics of Race Really Work, written and read by Remi Adekoya. Introduction. What Children See. In 2011, a group of psychologists decided to investigate the racial attitudes of children in South Africa. A diverse group of primary school kids aged 4 to 9 were presented photographs of people representing various racial groups and asked to point to who they liked. It turned out black, white, and colored, multiracial children, all favored white people. While earlier studies in other multiracial societies had revealed similar pro-white biases among children, these had all been conducted in Europe and North America. It had been assumed children in those places favored whites because they were the dominant majority group upheld as the norm. This was obviously not the case in South Africa, which was 80% black and just 9% white. While such pro-white biases may have been unsurprising during the apartheid era, where the state openly glorified whiteness, these kids were growing up under black presidents and governments in a South Africa that emphasized racial equality, a country whose most respected individual was a black man by the name of Nelson Mandela. The authors of the study suggested the children's pro-white biases could be motivated by their perceptions of group status in South Africa. Research has shown children favor higher status groups over lower status ones. Hispanic kids favor whites over African Americans. African American kids favor whites over Hispanics. White Australian kids favor Asians over Aborigines. Taiwanese kids favor whites over blacks. And British Asian kids have been shown to favor whites over British Caribbean kids, while the latter favored whites over British Asians. The question then was what criteria South African kids were using to assess group status in their society. It clearly wasn't group size. Their preferences appeared to mirror the country's wealth hierarchy, but was it possible children that age even noticed who owned what? Subsequent studies revealed they did. Presented pictures of nice houses and fancy cars, juxtaposed with images of shacks and beat-up jalopies, children as young as 3 matched the expensive possessions first to whites and then to multiracials, while often associating the shacks and jalopies with black people. At the time, average income for white South African households was 3 times that of multiracial households and 7 times that of black households. So the kids were accurately noting the correlation between race and wealth in their country. This mattered in shaping their attitudes towards various groups, as further research revealed that they preferred the affluent. Presented pictures of expensively dressed children in fancy houses and poorly dressed children in shabby ones, irrespective whether they themselves were black or white or from rich or poor homes, the children liked the affluent kids more and were keener to befriend them. Shown 2 black kids, one presented as rich, the other as poor, they preferred the rich black kid. Similar studies in America have shown primary school children can distinguish between rich and poor people in photographs, generally favor the rich, and associate wealth with whiteness and poverty with blackness. 5-year-olds are obviously too young to have developed any coherently classist worldviews, so psychologists have pondered why they gravitate towards the better off. Some suggest they are simply attracted by the aesthetically pleasing possessions money can buy, and transfer the wow feelings they experience at the sight of a shiny toy or sleek car onto their owners. Others think they perceive potential benefits from being around affluent kids, such as being allowed to play with their fancy toys. One study in 2 very economically and culturally different environments, the US and India, showed American children from predominantly middle-class families and Indian children from lower-income families both believed children from wealthy homes were likelier to share than children from poor homes. Likely because they were assuming kids from wealthy homes simply have more available to share and can do so at less cost than those who have little. It is easier for a kid with 5 toy cars to offer his peers one of them to play with than it is for a kid with only 1 toy car to give it up for someone else. Whatever the underlying factors behind these dynamics, such findings reveal children's sensitivity to information that is ubiquitous in society, but often neglected by those interested in the development of social attitudes and stereotypes, one study concluded. In today's race debate, it would seem we are either neglecting the obvious or unwilling to discuss it frankly and in detail. Much of the anger and frustration around race today is driven by popular feelings that racial hierarchies still permeate our world. That while no longer formalized as during apartheid, colonialism, or slavery, we continue to live in a world in which white people are positioned at the top, black people at the bottom, and everyone else somewhere in between, an order that has been with us for some 500 years now. This feeling is particularly strong within the group that feels stuck at the bottom. A 2020 CNN survey of UK ethnic minorities revealed that on issues ranging from police treatment to chances of life success in Britain, the results are striking. It is often the case that black people are considerably more dissatisfied with race relations than other ethnic minorities. For instance, 69% of black people in Britain believe they have fewer opportunities to succeed professionally than white people, compared with 49% of non-black minorities. An ITV poll that same year showed black people were the most likely to describe Britain's police, justice system, education system, parliament, and corporate world, as well as sports, arts, and beauty industries, as plagued by a culture of racism. A 2021 Ipsos survey confirmed the trend of black people seeing themselves as the most unfairly treated group in Britain. Meanwhile, in the US, a 2021 Pew Research study showed 58% of African Americans believe that to achieve racial equality in their country, most US laws and institutions need to be completely rebuilt as they are fundamentally biased. In comparison, 30% of Hispanics and 24% of Asian Americans believe such a radical overhaul necessary, meaning black Americans are at least twice as likely to believe the system is currently rigged against them as those in other major white groups. In a 2019 survey, more than half, 52%, of black adults in America said being black has hurt their ability to get ahead, compared to a quarter of Hispanics and Asians, 24% each. Black dissatisfaction with the status quo is not restricted to those living in Britain and America or even the West. In recent years, the Black Lives Matter slogan has also resonated with Africans living in Africa who have never met a white police officer and face no personal racism in their daily lives. Their day-to-day struggles are very different from those of the black person in Britain or America. Yet following major events that bring the race issue to the fore, such as the killing of George Floyd in 2020, they unite with the black diaspora in a shared sense of global disregard for blackness. Their sentiments, while consciously intensified and exploited by race activists, are reflective of the global reality. Whether it is Libyans selling black Africans into slavery in the 21st century, Chinese people paying $70 to watch videos of Malawian children made to chant, "I'm a monster, my IQ is low," or Indians openly discriminating against black people in their country, a general disregard for blackness appears to be a constant. A 2021 UN report found discrimination against black people happens pretty much everywhere outside Africa. Hence, while various groups complain of a persisting racial hierarchy, it is the particularly stark contrast between the position of black and white that is really driving today's increasingly bitter and polarized race debate. It is no coincidence that today's anti-racism movement is driven by intellectuals and activists of black descent. The story of how the current racial order emerged is one we are familiar with. The transatlantic slave trade, colonialism, Western imperialism, and the ideology of white supremacy were all key to establishing its ranking. The issue today is what is sustaining this now informal order, despite the plethora of moral and intellectual arguments leveled against it over the years. Why has it not ended when so many say they are completely against it? Hierarchical orders reflect differences in power and status. The key question, therefore, is what gives some racial groups more power and status than others in today's world. When I refer to power, I mean the ability to influence events, environments, and people. By influence, I mean being able to have an effect on what happens, what places are like, and how people think and behave. Whether that effect is positive or negative is up to the beholder, As long as an effect has occurred, influence has been exercised, and power has been exerted. Understood this way, it's clear everyone has some power in this world, as we are all able to influence some events, environments, and people in our lives. Where individuals and groups have come to differ vastly, and what is causing much frustration, is in the degree and scope of their power in this world. This will be the subject of this book with regards to the race equation. When I refer to status in the book, I simply mean where others position us as individuals or groups in the grand scheme of things. The fact that our status depends not on how we see ourselves, but on how others see us, is a crucial dynamic in the whole equation. A writer's literary status, for instance, has nothing to do with what the writer thinks of their writing, and everything to do with what others think of it. In this book, I argue that the chief source of racial group power and status today is collective wealth. It is not the only thing that matters, but it is the thing that matters the most in a capitalist world. Money creates and sustains hierarchies. I will thus be looking at how it influences racial dynamics in several key domains of our modern world, ranging from immigration, knowledge, technology, and media, to group stereotypes, allocation of prestige, and international power. This is not just about the raw purchasing power money provides. It is also very much about the meaning people assign to wealth and the qualities they attribute to those who wield it. The material dynamics of race relations shape their psychological dynamics, but the latter are no less important in the current equation. If 5-year-olds are already forming attitudes towards groups shaped by whether they see them as haves or have-nots, how much more so adults navigating a world in which pretty much everything costs money? Much has been said about whiteness in recent years, in the name of dismantling white supremacy. Most of it is soaked in the kind of wishful thinking only possible in the minds of modern-day Westerners, that most shielded group of humans in human history. The race equation resembles what it resembles today, not because the ideology of white supremacy is so diabolically clever it continues to bamboozle the world for no logical reason. We are where we are because the current global order has a very solid structural foundation. Racism does not explain its persistence. The solidity of that foundation does. We live in a world in which single European states like Britain and Germany have larger economies than Africa, a continent of 1.4 billion people and home to roughly 90% of the world's black population. If you created a single economy comprising all the 60-plus black majority countries in the world, including the Caribbean nations, their combined GDP still wouldn't amount to Germany's $4 trillion figure. We can debate colonialism, slavery, and Western imperialism all we want, but that won't change the economic realities of our world. Nor will arguing that the West would never have got to where it is today if not for its exploitative past make whites any poorer, less powerful, or less high status in the eyes of the world. Despite all the talk of white exploitation and racism over the years, whiteness continues to enjoy a defiant glow such accusations appear incapable of diminishing. A race debate not embedded in detailed material realities is intellectual masturbation. It is high time for a relentless focus on the realities sustaining global hierarchies and how they manifest in our everyday lives. To be effective, this requires a more global view of racial dynamics than the parochial Anglo-American lens that dominates today's race debate on both left and right. What happens in Britain and America matters, as these are both influential countries. But events in London and New York are not going to decide the future of global race relations. Less than 3% of the world's black population currently live in the US and UK combined. Moreover, this share of the global black population will shrink to less than 2% by 2050, when Africa is expected to have a population of 2.5 billion people. For some perspective, there are already 5 times more Nigerians than black Americans. And Nigeria's population will surpass that of the entire United States by 2050. The West is also home to but a tiny proportion of other non-white populations, likewise unhappy with the current order. The demographic reality is such that it is global-scale dynamics which will shape the future of race relations, not their manifestations in this or that Western society however important. I will use the term racial groups in this book quite often, even though it is a highly imprecise term. There are 1.4 billion Indians, but it is not clear if they are to be considered a distinct racial group or categorized as brown people, as folk from South Asia and the Middle East are often talked about. When I do use the term racial groups, it should be understood to refer to groups of people who are popularly identified and treated as if they were members of a same race. When I refer to brown, black, or white people, it is simply in the spirit of reflecting how the complicatedly diverse peoples of this world are racially categorized in popular perceptions. This book is generally very focused on the role of mass sentiments in race relations, as these affect people's everyday lives more than the views of particular individuals here and there, myself included, of course. As for me, I was born and raised in Nigeria to a Nigerian father and Polish mother, rendering me a first-hand witness to the black-white dynamic from my earliest years. My wife is Nigerian and my daughter British-Nigerian, so I have a vested interest in the present and future status of blackness. I write this from that perspective. I identify strongly with the African continent in its entirety, though I also lived in my mother's homeland for many years and have called Britain home since 2015. My formative experiences growing up in Lagos were key to shaping my understanding of how the world works, black perceptions of whiteness, and the power of money. Living in the rich North and in the often much poorer South are two vastly different experiences bound to shape your worldview quite differently. I have lived both here and there and drawn my observations from both worlds. While other groups will be discussed where context demands it, my main focus will be on the dynamics between black and white, as I firmly believe it is the interplay between these two that will continue to drive the race debate in this century. I hope to shed some light on how collective wealth shapes racial status in everyday life and what the future holds for the current order. Chapter 1: A Picture of Racial Wealth. Our world is organized into national economies that are constantly being measured against each other. News reports will regularly inform us of how Britain is now not the fastest growing economy in Europe, Nigeria is Africa's largest economy, or China's GDP looks set to surpass America's in such and such year. We hear of which economies are doing well and which are doing badly. While nations are made up of diverse groups, virtually all the nations in the world contain a clear racial majority. Britain is 82% white. 9 in 10 of Europe's inhabitants are white. Even in the US, by far the most racially diverse Western nation, whites constitute 71% of the population. While the West has no doubt undergone significant demographic changes in recent decades, it remains a predominantly white world. Conversely, Africa is predominantly black, containing, as mentioned earlier, 9 in 10 of the world's black people. In terms of the other racial identity categories often spoken about, Asians are obviously from a huge collection of nations and range from the Chinese to the Indians and more than a few in between. Nevertheless, the average global citizen will likely distinguish chiefly between those who hail from the Middle East, often referred to as the Arab world, even though many other groups inhabit the region, South Asians and East Asians. And of course, there is the popular belief in the existence of a Latino group, chiefly located in South America. It is thus possible, based on available national and international data, to draw a picture of racial wealth that is broadly reflective of our global reality. While the economic rise of some non-white nations, chiefly in Asia, is undoubtedly reshaping the world order, the upper echelons of the global economy remain dominated by white majority nations. Despite being home to just 17% of the world's population, Europe and North America still account for roughly half of its $101 trillion GDP. 6 of the 10 largest economies in the world today are white majority nations. As at 2022, Sweden, a country of 10 million people, generated a GDP of $603 billion, compared to $504 billion for Nigeria, the largest black nation with 214 million inhabitants. Tiny Ireland, with its 5 million citizens, had a GDP of $520 billion, in comparison to $411 billion in the case of South Africa, the most industrialized black majority nation with a population of 60 million. The economic gap is not just between black and white, of course. Norway's 5 million strong economy boasts a GDP of $505 billion against the $461 billion generated by Bangladesh, which has 170 million people. 9 million Swiss citizens live in an $807 billion economy, more than twice the size of Pakistan's $376 billion GDP, despite the latter having a population of 235 million. Britain's economy is roughly equal to India's in size, despite the latter having 20 times more citizens and generally being on the rise in recent years. The differences are most visible in GDP per capita figures, crucial to gauging the average living standards and buying power of individual citizens. 16 of the 20 nations with the highest GDP per capita in the world are white majority countries. At the other end, 18 of the 20 countries with the lowest GDP per capita are black majority nations. Luxembourg has a GDP per capita 471 times that of Burundi, $125,923 compared to $267. For a broader picture, 33 of the 50 nations with the highest GDP per capita are white majority, while 30 of the 50 with the lowest are black majority. There is not a single white majority nation in the poorest 50 group. All are non-white. Of course, there are major economic differences between white majority nations, with UK GDP per capita standing at $42,000 compared to $15,000 in Romania. However, an indication of just how better off than most others white majority countries are is the fact that China, despite its ongoing economic miracle, still ranks lower than Romania, Croatia, or Hungary in terms of per capita GDP, even though these countries are relatively poor by European standards. The fact that Britain has a GDP per capita of $42,000, equivalent to £33,000, does not by any means translate to everyone in the UK earning £33,000 a year. These are average economic output figures, which obscure often significant disparities within rich societies, and there are plenty of complaints about that. But they do give us a snapshot of the economic strength of these nations compared to others. Sub-Saharan Africa is the poorest region in the world, with a GDP per capita of $1,800, compared to Europe's $34,000 and North America's $57,000. In between those extremes, the figure stands at $2,400 for South Asia, $8,700 for South America, $17,000 for East Asia, and $19,000 for the Middle East region. The World Bank defines the global middle class as those earning at least $12,535 a year, which comes out to just over $1,000 a month. This may seem a modest income to Westerners, which just shows how much richer than others they are, but sounds about right in a global context. As of today, 8 in 10 Europeans and 9 in 10 North Americans reach this global middle-class income threshold. In China, it is 1 in 4. In Latin America, it's 1 in 6. And in the Middle East, it's 1 in 9. In South Asia and Africa, where most of the world's black and brown populations are concentrated, just 1 in 50 people, 2% of the population, have monthly incomes exceeding $1,000. Britain has a larger number of people qualifying as global middle class than the whole of Africa or South Asia. Future trends bode well for China, which is expected to see its share of citizens with global middle class incomes double to 52% by 2030, while South Asia's share is also expected to double, but to a much more modest 4%. The proportion in South America is expected to inch up to 18%, while the figure in Africa is expected to remain stagnant at a mere 2%. This is because while African economies are expected to grow, their populations are growing even faster, which means that while there will be more collective income, there will also be many more around to share it. The differences are even more glaring when it comes to levels of household wealth in the world's regions. By the end of 2021, global household wealth totaled an estimated $464 trillion. North America and Europe together account for 57% of total household wealth, again, despite containing just 17% of the world's adult population. North American households held $158 trillion, while European households held $106 trillion. Chinese households held $85 trillion. Households in the Asia-Pacific region held $81 trillion. Indian households, $14 trillion, while South American households boasted $12 trillion in wealth. African households were by far the collective poorest, holding $6 trillion in wealth. If all the household wealth in North America was converted into its cash value and distributed equally among its inhabitants, each adult in the region would receive a check for $561,000. Respectively, each European would pocket $180,000, while their Chinese and Asian Pacific counterparts could count on $77,000 and $65,000. Each South American adult would receive $28,000, and each Indian adult $15,000. Each African would receive $8,000. For the record, if all the world's wealth was distributed equally among its adults, irrespective of country of origin, each individual would get $87,000. Of the 20 countries with the highest median wealth per adult in the world, 14 were white majority nations. Britain was number 9, just ahead of France and behind Netherlands. Median wealth per adult in the UK was 83 times what it was in Nigeria, 41 times what it was in India, 38 times what it was in Brazil, 27 times what it was in South Africa, and 5 times what it was in China. Millionaires are extremely rare in the global south, around 1 in 1,000 adults in India and Indonesia, and 1 in 200 in China. In the likes of Italy and Spain, your chances of encountering a millionaire at random rise to 1 in 33. In Britain, it's 1 in 20, in the US, 1 in 11, and in Switzerland, 1 in 6. Household wealth grew in the West during the coronavirus pandemic. Aside from the fact people spent less than usual because they stayed indoors, rich country citizens received massive government support via furloughs, checks in the mail, and whatnot. Poor country citizens could count on no such largesse when their economies froze to a standstill. To live in a poor country is to be dealt a double whammy. You will likely have very little money, and so will your government. Britain wields a national budget of £1 trillion, 33 times the size of Nigeria's budget, despite the latter having well over 3 times more people. The UK's budget is more than double that of India, which again has 20 times more people. Ethiopia, Africa's second largest nation with a population of 115 million, wielded a national budget of $13 billion in 2021 for education, healthcare, infrastructure, everything. Slovakia, which has 5 million people and is hardly a rich country by European standards, had a budget twice that size. The picture in terms of per capita budget figures mirrors that of GDP per capita figures, with white majority nations generally dominating the upper ranks, along with a few wealthy East Asian states, while most governments of the global south have very scarce resources per citizen to spend on providing healthcare, education, infrastructure, and other social needs. As a result, during the pandemic, people in the global south had to draw on whatever savings they had to survive, causing household wealth to shrink in many black and brown nations, further exacerbating the racial wealth gap. The COVID experience was a great example of the role collective white wealth plays in advantaging white people over most of the rest of the world. What worsens the racial wealth gap, of course, is that even within rich Western societies, the big picture hierarchy tends to be replicated, with white people having the most, black people the least, and everyone else somewhere in between. The median white British household is worth £314,000 compared to £34,000 for the median black African household. In between these two extremes are the other racial groups, with British Indians being the exceptional case of a group whose typical wealth matches that of whites. The pattern repeats itself in America, where the typical white family owns 5 times the wealth of the typical Hispanic family and 8 times that of the typical black family. The black and white wealth gap in America is as wide today as it was in the 1960s. These are the Western nations that compile detailed racial wealth statistics. Others don't. I would, however, risk a guess that the racial wealth hierarchy in all Western nations is not ordered much differently than in the UK and the US, especially with regards to who sits at top and at bottom. Neither is the racial wealth gap restricted to Western countries. In South America, where 133 million Afro-descendants constitute the largest black population outside Africa, they are overrepresented among the poor in every country. In Brazil, where the largest group lives, they are twice as likely to be poor as white Brazilians. Even in Uruguay, one of the most egalitarian nations in Latin America, Afro-Uruguayans are three times more likely to be poor. Afro-descendants are about twice as likely to live in slums as non-Afro-descendants in Brazil, Colombia, Costa Rica, Ecuador, Mexico, and Uruguay. Regionally, they are over 2.5 times more likely to live in chronic poverty than whites or mestizos. During the first half of the 20th century in Colombia, black was even used as a way of referring to poor groups, even if they were not black. So synonymous was blackness with poverty. The South Americans descended from European ancestors are at the top of the economic hierarchy, while blacks are at the bottom. I am discussing here racial wealth gaps that are, of course, different from racial income gaps that also exist, but are narrowing in many cases. In Britain, there is now a higher percentage of British Indians and British Chinese in the top income quintile, top fifth of earners, after housing costs, than British whites, with the figure standing at 24%, 22%, and 21% respectively. The figure is 8% for Black Britons and 4% for British Pakistanis. Similar trends are observable in the US, where, for instance, Asian women and men have been shown to earn more than their white, black, and Hispanic counterparts. One striking US study in 2018 showed that black Americans' disadvantage on social mobility relative to whites is entirely driven by a disadvantage between black and white men. No matter what their parents' income level, black men do worse than white men on average in today's America, but the same does not hold for black women. While the study still found white women earning more on average than black women, in this case, the gap could be explained by differences in family background. Conditional on their parents' income, black women actually outperform white women in terms of individual earnings, the study noted. There are a myriad national and even regional specific factors affecting income inequalities between groups today.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.